The outlook for the CBD market. The use of CBD is growing rapidly worldwide, and several factors, particularly regulation and consumer attitudes, look set to define the next stage in this exciting market. Founder and CEO, Voyager Life, from the United Kingdom, Nick Tulloch.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning or good afternoon. I appreciate many of you are joining in different parts of the world. Thank you very much for listening to me, and thank you also for inviting me back. I very much enjoyed speaking at last year's conference, and it's a real pleasure to be asked to come and talk to you again. As you just heard, I'd like to talk a little bit about the outlook for the CBD market. What I'll do is I'll just briefly set the scene by telling you a little bit about who I am and my experience, and then I'll go on and I'll talk about what's changed in the CBD market, how things are growing, and just a few things that companies ought to be looking out for. For those of you who have heard me before, you'll know some of this already. I am in some ways quite new to the CBD market, and in some ways maybe more experienced professional. I have been involved in CBD for around about 4 years now, but this is my second CBD company. I previously ran a business called Zoetic International, which I joined some years back and helped them transform from their previous business into a CBD and cannabis business. Now, that all went very well, but as clearly all of you will know, the COVID pandemic has changed a number of things in our lifestyles. And in my case, one of them was not being able to get to America. I'm based over here in the UK, and traveling from the UK to the US became, frankly, became impossible during COVID. So during last year, I set up a new CBD company, started it from the very beginning. It's called Voyager. And what it does is very similar to Zoetic. It's entirely a CBD business. We sell oral, topical products. We also make a number of products out of hemp. Before I got involved with Zoetic and CBD, I was initially a lawyer and then after that, a financial advisor. So I've tended to approach the industry maybe a little bit different to some of your other speakers. I've come at it very much from a financial perspective and really thinking more about the investment capabilities in the business. And you'll probably see that as I go through my presentation in terms of how I tend to approach things. As I say, I'm going to start with just a few brief introductions to the growth and the scale of the CBD market. Now, although I'm based over in the UK, I tend to follow US statistics, largely because the US market is somewhat better developed than the UK or the European market. I think some of the numbers are a little bit more informative coming out of the US in terms of what we can expect both in Europe and also around the world. I won't read everything on the screen. You'll be able to do that for yourselves, but I'll just pick out a few of the highlights. But what you can see from this slide is that around about two-thirds of Americans are familiar with CBD, and also of those who've used it, found it to be effective. And a total of 64 million Americans say they have tried CBD over the last 2 years. I think it's interesting as well at the very last point that there are four times more people searching for CBD on Google than there are searching for THC. I suspect having gone back a few years, we would have found that number really quite different, with THC perhaps being more popular. But what we're beginning to see here is that CBD as a health and wellness product is really trumping THC runs right across the use and sort of search databases. A couple of sort of charts that again a few more statistics on this slide. Probably no great surprise if you're in the 18 to 24 age group, you're probably twice as likely to have used CBD as you would have if you were in the over 65 age group. I'm sort of somewhere between that in my ages, but. You know, what I can say from my own upbringing is that it was impressed upon me right from the start that marijuana is dangerous, marijuana is illegal, marijuana is not to be used. And so to an extent, my own generation comes with a slight inbuilt perspective as to the risks and the issues around marijuana. Now, clearly, in my own industry, I'm beginning to learn that that's actually really quite different. But what we do find is that there are more young people who are receptive to the idea of CBD. So if you project that forward, as those 18 to 24s become 25s to 34s and 35s to 44s, we should expect to see that also translated to higher CBD use. As for the reasons for taking CBD, well, you can see that You can see that yourselves in terms of the reasons why people are using the product. Pain, anxiety, stress, these are the most popular areas. But just look at the tail on those on that chart. As more products become available and as more research becomes available, there's a far greater number of reasons why people are beginning to use the product. And that's, again, sort of borne out by the rise in popularity of CBD. Again, I'm going to turn back to the US just to sort of talk about the growth in CBD. Here over the last 7 years, you can see how CBD is beginning to grow, you know, almost exponentially. So in 7 years, the US market is forecast to have increased by around about four times. Sorry about that. What I think is particularly interesting is that, again, if you look at the very last bullet point on the slide, 3 years ago, 80% of the world's growth in CBD was estimated to come from America, from the Americas. But last year, only 37%. So in other words, what we're finding is that although CBD continues to grow at a phenomenal rate over in the US, it's actually growing faster elsewhere. The rest of the world is catching up. And we're seeing really right around the world increased use in CBD and CBD products and reasons for taking CBD. There's more hemp being grown, and certainly in the US, you can see that on the slide, but also elsewhere around the world. This is an industry that maybe is still only in its infancy, but is very much here to stay. So that all sounds pretty good, doesn't it? You know, why wouldn't you want to be in the CBD market? So at this point, I'll turn to that great philosopher and well-known spokesman, Mike Tyson. I can't say I'm a subscriber to many of the things he said, but everybody has a plan until they get punched in the face. And that, to an extent, encapsulates the CBD market at the moment. It all sounds wonderful, but sometimes things aren't always as they seem. Let me just talk about some of the challenges facing the CBD market. I'll start over on the top left. I'll work my way around. Regulations. In some ways, CBD is crying out to be regulated. There are different products, different categories, different enforcements, and frankly, different rules around the world. If you're a CBD company and you're looking to sell internationally, then why would you not? You look around the world, the most successful businesses themselves are, of course, all international. But in CBD, you're challenged with different approaches in different countries, different regions that you deal with. Investor attitudes have also changed considerably. Again, what we've found is that some years ago, Canada led the way in terms of the legalization and support of the industry. America followed. Europe had its moment really just a few months ago, earlier this year. But investors have begun to be a little bit more circumspect about CBD. They're tiring of the overhyped and unrealistic business plans and some of the disappointments they're finding for companies who are making really sort of vast and unsubstantiated promises, which are just beginning to pull investment away from the sector. Along with investors, there's also consumer distrust. There are products that simply don't work. There are products that are perhaps poorly labeled, poorly described. And one of the issues that we have in my own company, Voyager, is customers come to us and say, well, look, you know, is this just snake oil? You know, are you selling something that actually is a fake, is fraud? You know, how do I know it actually works? And to an extent, all of us are fighting the less scrupulous players across the industry. Information, of course, is important. You know, again, we're an industry that's right in its infancy. And what people want to see is information. They want to see clear labeling, and they want to understand the products they're taking. One of the big successes we have at Voyager is we supply point of sale information to our customers. Now, this can sometimes be as simple as leaflets and posters, in very low technology, but just ways of explaining to customers what the products are. And that, I think, is an area that we'll see continue to grow across the future as customers want more information. And I think the successful retailers and the successful companies will be those that actually can provide that information and help their customers in the understanding of what the product is and why someone might want to take it. So with that in mind, what should a CBD company do? What we know now is that the industry is growing at an extraordinary rate. We know there are some challenges and some headwinds. If you're setting up a CBD company, or if you're looking to establish a new business or grow your own, what should you think about? Well, here are four ideas. Quality is absolutely paramount. No customer is going to come back and buy again and again unless they're happy that the product works. It has to taste good, it has to feel good, it has to smell good. It clearly has to achieve what the customer wants. There isn't going to be any room going forward for low quality products. And I'll say, sadly, we do have those. I mentioned information before. Customers want to know what CBD can do, what's in the product, what it will do for them, how they should take it, when they should take it, what time of day, how much they should take it. And sometimes we leave too much to customers' imagination. If you pick up a tub of vitamin C tablets, for example, in the local pharmacy, it will be quite clear as to how many you should take, what the vitamin C tablet has got in it, and we should apply exactly the same with CBD. Proper labeling, detailed labeling, full list of ingredients, full list of allergens, why people take the product, and also in some cases when they should take the product, morning, afternoon, night. Everyone will have different requirements, but customers do require that information. I'll talk more about outlets in a subsequent slide, but although the temptation, as we listen to the press, is that everything's online at the moment, an awful lot of customers, and this links back to information, an awful lot of customers want to talk to an advisor and understand the relevance of a CBD product to their lifestyle. So it shouldn't all be about online, and actually getting the product into stores is extremely important. Finally, compliance. This is a highly, highly regulated industry, and we should all expect regulations to increase going forward. Being a brand that can demonstrate full and absolute compliance with the rules is the only way to ensure trust and confidence in your customers. And that's both trade customers, also retail customers. This was paramount, I think, around about a year ago. But as CBD has continued to grow, I find more and more companies are essentially taking chances, perhaps paying lip service regulations, but we cannot expect major retailers to stock our products unless we are fully compliant with everything that we do and should do across the CBD industry. I talked about outlets, and I said a moment ago, it's very tempting to say everything's about online sales at the moment. Again, back to US statistics, what you can see on this slide is that customers are more likely to buy from dispensaries and retail stores than they are to buy online. Online sales are perhaps the easiest way to start a business. They're certainly the highest margin way to sell products, but actually customers do like coming in to speak to a customer advisor and understand exactly what it is they're selling. As I said, there's a few reasons for that. The information point I mentioned is important. That general distrust, and also just classic retail. People like to see and touch and smell what they buy. You can see this, the display from one of our own shops on the right-hand side. It is possible to display CBD in a very attractive, confident health and wellness style, and that works extremely well, and we shouldn't lose sight of that. There's a place for online sales, of course, but there's also a place for old-fashioned bricks and mortar sales. 31% of CBD users, this is as estimated by Brightfield, have been doing so for less than a year. CBD is perhaps one of the few industries which has had a beneficial effect from the pandemic, as people have been staying at home. There's been greater issues of anxiety, of mental health, of just people wanting to look after themselves and feel good and look good. And we have seen a continued growth in CBD. What we find, though, what we can see, is this is a fantastic opportunity now for new companies and existing companies to win new customers, to excite them with new products, and to create a lifelong following. What a fantastic opportunity in some ways the current environment has given us. There are expectations from investors and also from some of the entrepreneurs that see their own businesses will grow almost exponentially overnight. They may well do, but again, I so often like to turn to other people's explanations, and Steve Jobs puts it very well. Overnight successes do take some planning. If you look, as he says, if you really look closely, they do take a lot of time. I'd like to finish just with a few observations as how I think the market will develop. As I said in the last few minutes, CBD is growing rapidly. In the UK, for example, CBD already exceeds vitamin C and vitamin D combined. The UK market, by the way, is estimated to be worth 650 million sterling, and that's up from previous estimates over the last few years. CBD is here to stay. It is now a official mainstream part of the health and wellness industry. But as I mentioned earlier, it's not all plain sailing, and successful operators do need to watch their business quite carefully. Quality is important, compliance regulations is essential, and as with every business, it's about demand. It's about what customers want. There's no point selling the products you want to sell. It's about selling the products that customers want to buy. So let me just give you two observations for next year. These are my own expectations, but I think CBD isolates will continue to excel. One of the enormous benefits of CBD isolate is it is compliant with the tightening of regulations around the world. So many countries are now monitoring CBD based on THC content. And as you extract a product from the hemp plant, you know, yes, it will contain CBD, but it will also contain THC. The UK, for example, limits THC content to 1 milligram. Other countries talk about percentages of 0.2% or 0.3% in some cases. But one of the more efficient ways of ensuring compliance with regulations is to use CBD isolate. It performs very well in lab tests and gives customers high level confidence of the quantity of CBD in the product, but also the lack of THC. The second point is product range. Again, I see this in my own business. I see this when I look at shelves and online portals. Knowledge of CBD from customers is growing. I mentioned they want information, but they're receiving and they're absorbing that information, and their expectations are increasing as well. Some years ago, CBD oils was really where it was at. That was the core product. Now customers want face creams, they want hand creams, they want gummies, they want mints, they want different ways of taking CBD. Nothing's going to change the quality, but the range of products will be absolutely key in terms of establishing a successful and a growing CBD business. So we're really very much at the beginning of CBD. I still see us here. This is still the tip of the iceberg. There's so much more to follow over the next few years. I have absolute confidence that growth will continue across the CBD market, certainly in the UK, Europe, and also worldwide. Countries are opening up to CBD all the time. But again, back to Mike Tyson's quote earlier in my presentation, it's not all plain sailing. There are challenges. And new entrants into the CBD market should be aware of the fact that, as I say, regulation, compliance, information is absolutely critical. Good quality products, a wide product range, well-marketed, well-labeled, and also marketed across a range of different outlets. You know, it doesn't have to be just online. Sell through stores, sell through partner stores. That's the way to build a successful CBD business. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for listening to me. I mean, it's an absolute pleasure to be back after last year. And thank you to Jackie. Thank you to the team. I hope you'll have a very successful conference and enjoy the rest of your day and enjoy the rest of the speakers. But it's a real pleasure to talk to you again this morning. Thank you.